This is a quick Fusion 360 tutorial on how to build the shaft based upon the diameter that we calculated using the spreadsheet. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into the Fusion 360 workspace, which is shown here. And there are a couple of little navigation items that are important. There's the home button, and then there's this viewing cube over here on the right that allows us to navigate around with different perspectives on the plane. But first thing we're going to do under the design tab up here on the upper left is we're going to click on create sketch, and it's going to ask us a plane to create that sketch. But even before we do that, I'm going to go under document settings and change my units to inches, because everything in this particular problem that we did in class was done in inches and pound force and all the like. I'm going to turn my origin on just so I can see everything. I am going to go under the sketch and produce a plane, and then I am going to draw my shaft based upon the diameter that we calculated using the spreadsheet. But first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to realize I have a 46-inch shaft, so I kind of want to center it about the origin. So I'm going to create a little construction line here, and I'm going to make that construction line 46 over 2, even though I could calculate that easily. I did that simply so I could see where the center of the shaft would be, and I could start my sketch over here at this leftmost point. That would be my origin O. So I'm going to go ahead and make a sketch. I'm going to make sure that it's no longer construction. I'm going to start over here, and I'm going to go up, and you see that the dimension is highlighted in blue. So I'm going to go 3.44 divided by 2. That's the radius that I want. Now I'm going to go ahead and grab another line. I'm going to go off to the right. I'm going to go 20 inches, which takes me to gear A, and then I am going to click there, and I'm going to go up 0.86, which is what I already calculated the shoulder height needs to be in order for me to have a capital D to small d radius ratio of 1.5. And the reason I choose that 1.5 is because that is the radius ratio that is used to estimate the stress concentration factors, these elastic stress concentration factors for sharp fillets at shoulders and shafts. So I want to be able to do an FEA and compare the stress at one of the shoulders from the FEA simulation to what I can do in a hand calculation. So I'm going to keep going now. I'm going to go off to the right another 16 inches, which would locate bearing B. And now I am going to go down 0.86 to make the same shoulder size, and then I'm going to go off to the right by another 10 inches, which would take me to the end of the shaft. And then I will click on that point. I will go down to the midpoint, I hope. Click, and then I come over and close the drawing. When it turns blue, it shows that I'm closed. I can escape and finish that sketch. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to activate that section, and I am going to look under the panel at the top. I'm either going to use create to revolve, which is exactly what I'm going to use. I'm going to revolve that sketch profile about an axis. Over here, I open a window on the right, the revolve window. It says I have a profile that's already selected. Now I need to select an axis, so I'm just going to highlight this axis. It goes 360. I'm creating a new body. You can make components. You can make bodies. That's entirely up to you. And I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And now I'm going to hit the home button in the upper right, and I have my simple little shaft. Now the next thing that I need to do is determine the fillet radius associated with the transition from little d to large d at the shoulder associated with bearing B and at the shoulder associated with gear A. You may recall when we started the example from lecture one is that the R over D ratio, which is a sharp fillet radius associated with the stress concentration factor of 2.7 at this shoulder, was for an R over D ratio equal to 0.02. That gives me a fillet radius. I'm going to modify. I'm going to add a fillet. I'm going to go ahead and zoom in here, and I am going to choose that little corner, and I'm going to add a fillet radius of 0.069 inches. I'm going to zoom out and go to the other side and do the same thing, 0.069. Got it. Now I have both of my fillet radii in there, and so this shaft is almost ready to go. The other thing that I want to do is I want to be able to create some locations where I can apply the bearing constraints. So at the left side at O, I have a bearing that is not going to allow translation of the end of the shaft. At bearing B over here, I have a bearing that will not allow motion according to the coordinate system I have here in either the Y or Z directions. Then I have a gear over here at the end of the shaft. I got to apply a load associated with that. And I got a gear that's going to be over here next to the other shoulder that I also have to apply a load for. So I have loads and torsions. I got to get all that stuff in there. And so I want to have targets when I move to the finite element simulation. I want to have targets for where I can put those things. In order to make this happen, I'm going to go ahead and click on the end of the shaft, and I'm going to go under Construct, Create an Offset Plane, and I'm going to move that plane in the negative direction. I'm going to move it back negative 0.1, just a tenth of an inch, which is going to intersect the shaft and create a very, very small ribbon between that plane and the end of the shaft. So if I were to look straight on that shaft, you might be able to see that there will be a little segment here. I am going to split the face. So I am going to split this face, that's the face where the gear goes on, and I am going to use this plane as a splitting tool. And what that did for me, if I now hide that plane by turning this little eyeball off, is it created a very nice little segment, which becomes a target for me to apply a load. I'm going to go and do that again for the bearings. I am going to click on this plane. I'm going to go ahead and construct an offset plane, and I'm going to come out, let me just go 0.5 inches in this direction. I'm going to come off of 0.5 inches to the right from the shoulder, and I'm going to go ahead and modify and split the face. So again, I'm going to split this face, and I'm going to use this plane as the tool to split that face. And now I'm going to do this again. I'm going to construct another offset plane, and I'm going to construct it here. And I came out a half an inch before, so I'm going to come out 0.6 inches. That's good. I am going to now do a modification and split the face. I don't want to split the body because I don't want to create new components, but I'm going to split that face with this plane like so. And now if I hide that plane, you will see that I have a nice little annulus that I can use to apply the bearing loads. So I'm going to go ahead and repeat that process again. I'm going to do the same thing on this side. I'm going to click on a plane where I want to create an offset plane. I'm going to create that offset plane. I'm going to move it out by a half an inch. I'm going to modify the surface because I'm trying to create a surface area where I can apply loads. So I'm going to go ahead and construct again another offset plane. This time I'll use the plane I already have, and I'll come another tenth of an inch out. And I am going to use that to split the face. I'm going to select this plane as my splitting tool. I'm going to say OK. I'm going to hide both of those planes and validate. Sure enough, I have a nice little annulus in there where I can apply the gear loads. I'm going to go and do that again back here, where I'm going to go ahead and create an offset plane. I'll go back minus 0.1. I will split this surface using that offset plane, and I've got all of the targets that I want. I'm going to hide the offset planes. I'm going to turn the little eyeball off on the origin. Now I have the things that I want, the basic things I want. I didn't put keyways in here yet, but this is enough. I got the fillet radii, I have the shoulder, I have locations where I can apply the bearing loads, a location where I can apply the force from gear C, location for force from gear A, and the bearing at Now that we have our shaft completely drawn, we are ready to move into the finite element space. To do that, we go over to the left-hand corner, click on the Design tab, and go to Simulation mode. Under Simulation, we are going to want to choose a static stress analysis. So it's in static equilibrium. Remember this. We're going to get elastic stress distributions, and from the FEA, we can calculate an elastic stress concentration factor, and we can compare that stress concentration factor to what we assumed the stress concentration factor was when we were doing our original analysis to determine the diameter of the shaft. And now in this space, what we have to do is study materials, and it is going to presume that this is a steel material. I'm not going to change anything about it right now. It's going to be good enough for what we need to do. And I have to impose some constraints on this. So under the tab up here that says structural constraints, I am going to click on structural constraints, and I am going to come over to the left-hand side, and I'm going to go ahead and make a pin constraint where I am allowing no radial deflection, no axial deflection, but the shaft can indeed spin. That's what that sort of constraint means. So the tangential motion is allowed. The shaft would be able to spin. And that's a lot like a bearing. It's not completely like a bearing, but it's a lot like a bearing. So that's good enough for now. All right, so we have that one structural constraint set. You can see the little, you can barely see it when I highlight it. There you go. You can see it over there on the left. That's a pin constraint. I'm going to add another constraint. And on that one, I'm going to go over to bearing B. I'm going to move and zoom in. I am going to select my target as this area right here. And now I'm going to look at the directions X, Y, and Z on my little cube, my space cube, which is determining the coordinate system. And I'm going to allow motion in the X direction, but I'm not going to allow motion in the Y and Z. All right, so that looks good. I'm going to click on the home button. It takes me back to the home appearance. Now I have my structural constraints. I'm going to go over here and I'm going to apply some structural loads. So the first thing I'm going to do is take a look at the forces that are being applied to the shaft. When we look carefully at the shaft that we designed, we realize that the position at O had reactions. Well, I've constrained it, so I don't have to include those forces in the analysis. The position over here at bearing B is constrained. Reactions are at B and O back here at O. We're not worried about those forces right now. Instead, what we want to do is apply the forces that are coming from the gears. So I am going to apply and I am going to click on this annulus, and I'm going to go ahead and apply a vector force to it. I have to change the units. Notice they pop up as newtons. I'm going to change the units to pound force before I do anything. And I have a y-directed force of minus 492 pounds. I have a z-directed force at gear C of 1,353 pounds. And if you look carefully at it, you will see that it has a z and a y component. I'm going to come over here and zoom in on the little annulus that I created where I could apply the force from gear A. Click on the loads tab. I'm going to apply a structural load. It's going to be a force. I'm going to select this annulus target, so I had to zoom in to do it. I got to change the units again. A y-directed force at gear A of 564 pounds, and we had a z-directed force at minus 205 pounds. And I've forgotten to put the moments on, so I got to go ahead and apply some moments. But before I do that, I can actually just look at the forces and evaluate the stress concentration factors that are brought about by forces that are applied to that. Those forces will give rise to bending moments, and we can compare those moments to what we calculated, and we can calculate stresses and evaluate stress concentration factors. So we could right now go to the mesh little icon over here on the left. We're going to edit that because I want to refine that mesh a little bit. We're going to dial back to 3%. You dial it back and then you hover over it and it shows 3%. Okay, so we're going to do that. And then I'm going to right click on it and generate that mesh. And these are the size elements that are going to be used to evaluate the stress distribution in the shaft. There you have it. Right, so now that I have that, you'll notice that I have a little pre-check bar up here at the top with a green check mark, meaning, okay, we have it properly constrained, we have loads applied, we can solve for this thing. So let's go ahead and do a solve. So now it is evaluating this thing on the cloud and will return for us the stress distribution. When we run the FEA, this is what we get. It always pops up as a safety factor instead of a stress distribution. And so it looks rather exaggerated as well. You can see pretty large deformations. That's because up in this little deformation tab, we have a deformation multiplier so we can see how this thing is bending. But sometimes it's useful to see that exaggerated deformation so you get an idea of how the shaft is bending. Now, I want to say a couple of things here. First, it always pops up a safety factor. We're going to want to look at the stress. And when we move into the stress space, you'll notice that it defaults to MPa because of the global settings I have on this program. But I'm going to change it to PSI because we're going to want to evaluate the stress distribution. And what we want to do is we want to pick out the maximum bending stress that's occurring on that fillet radius. That is the local stress that's going to be controlling the failure of the shaft and fatigue. So we want to zoom in there and find that local stress. And we use this tool, this inspection probe tool, to find that. We create a point probe, and then we have to start searching around to find where the maximum is. And you'll see I have 8,129 PSI. Now, you want to rotate the shaft, you want to look carefully, but I'm going to go ahead and click on that, and I'm going to keep that and use that in a calculation, because what I want to do is compare my maximum local stress from the FEA to what we would get using hand calculations. Now, there's something else that we need to do. I'm going to go zoom back out, and I'm going to go to actual deformation. You must understand that when we do this evaluation, and the way I built the model is that I applied my loads from the constraint from the bearing and the load that is applied on the gear over here at a location that is slightly different from the calculation we did in our spreadsheet. In the spreadsheet, we had the load applied directly at the transition shoulder. We had the reaction support directly at the transition shoulder. That is going to change the magnitude of the bending stress that is associated with the shoulder. Because we move the load over a little bit, we do not expect to get perfect agreement. There's a number of reasons not to get perfect agreement, but that's the first one right off the bat. So don't worry if you don't get perfect agreement. What you have to do is understand why it would not agree precisely with what you get from your hand calculation. And that's the first